over to. Thank you. Do family history and genetics seal the Alzheimer's deal? What every family with a history of dementia can do to prevent cognitive decline and take control of their future? You will find in this presentation that Randy and Eric have a plethora of just interesting information that you can do today in order to improve your future, your fate, and it's not all set up to your family history or your genetics. Three things that you can do, I'm gonna give to you now as promised. Diet. What you put into your body really is going to make a huge impact in what happens in your brain health, in your gut health, and keeping away inflammation. Randy and Eric are going to explain to you really those details. Exercise, not really finding that you have a lot of time to be able to do exercise. It does make a huge difference. I know in this time of COVID that things seem to be scrambling and you have to be creative in how you get some of your exercise. And then sleep. So many of us want to say, if I work longer or harder or put in the hours, it's going to come back to me. But really what happens is the lack of sleep really does come back to you. So without further ado, I'm going to introduce our presenters today. You don't need to hear from me. And we'll go ahead and dive right in. We do have the chat box. I see some of you have jumped on board there. We would love to hear some feedback from you as to if you have a family history of Alzheimer's or dementia. We'd love to get some feedback if you know what type of Alzheimer's or dementia has been diagnosed in your family. One thing that we have found is you might say that your grandparents or your aunt or your grandmother's grandmother had it, but really it was never diagnosed. You just knew something. But now research is really showing us that there are many different types of Alzheimer's or dementia, and uncovering what the root cause of them really is what's going to give you the opportunity to have a different fate. So without further ado, let me introduce my team. We have Eric Collette. Can you give Eric a little wave and a hi? Because if you Hello. Don't say something, then you don't pop up on the screen. Excellent. Eric Collette is the principal and CEO of A Mind for All Seasons. He's a nationally recognized speaker, consultant, and dementia expert, a licensed residential care administrator, and a teacher at Boise State University and the College of Western Idaho. Eric passionately believes that lifelong learning is a key to finding powerful new solutions to significant challenges, and has been working to change lives through innovative dementia care techniques, program development, and leadership strategies since 2000. Randy Vaudry. Randy, give a little shout out and a wave.
Hi, guys.
Randy Vaudry is the Chief Medical Officer at A Mind for All Seasons, a nurse practitioner with extensive experience in hospital, skilled nursing, psychiatric care, and primary care settings. He joined A Mind for All Seasons in 2017 to collaborate on the production, training, and delivery of assessment tools and treatment protocols that improve the lives and functional capacity of those living with Alzheimer's disease and other types of dementia. Randy's endeavors have formed the bulk of the Enhanced Protocol, A Mind for All Seasons signature product. Much of his work has been influenced by the research of Dale Bredesen, a pioneering neurologist and Alzheimer's researcher from whom Randy has received training in techniques to improve cognitive functioning. Just as a note, A Mind for All Seasons is our medical partner in the Enhanced Protocol and the memory clinic that we do have at the Summit at Sutherland Springs. And then finally, we have Robeson Flynn. Robeson, give us a little wave and a shout out.
Good morning.
He is our memory coach at the Summit at Sutherland Springs, located in Mesa, Arizona. He's been helping seniors with dementia in various roles for the better part of a decade. He has spearheaded the Enhanced Protocol at the Summit since its inception over 4 years ago. Before that, he worked on redesigning their memory care resident program, focusing on stimulating residents' cognitively, emotionally, and physically. Thank you, Robeson. And for all the rest of you out there, my name is Lori Marsh. I am the marketing director over at the Summit at Sunrun Springs, assisted living and memory care. And it is my great pleasure to be able to bring these presentations to you. It offers the opportunity to put some insight, some information out there, and be able to help you realize that there are some options that can improve not only your quality of life when dealing with cognitive decline, but also that senior living is not really what it was 30 years ago. It's an actual, as I call it, float, cruise ship that's just docked. So without further ado, Eric, let me send it on over to you to kick us off about genetics and how much it really contributes to Alzheimer's or dementia.
Thank you so much, Lori. Well, thank you for watching, everybody. It's great to be with all of you today. It was years ago that I first heard the term silver tsunami. I don't remember who said it to me, but they were mentioning, hey, did you hear about the silver tsunami that's coming? And it's this projected tidal wave of an increase in seniors needing a lot of assistance. Let's consider a few sobering statistics. There, one in nine adults, 45 and older, reports having some kind of cognitive decline. And one in three seniors currently dies with Alzheimer's disease or another type of dementia. No wonder people are worried about this. And as we watch the rates of Alzheimer's disease increase, people are talking about it more and more because with increased frequency, families are not coming through unscathed. Somebody in the family seems to have Alzheimer's disease or someone that the family's associated with. Right now, there are more than 5 million people in the United States and more than 50 million people worldwide diagnosed with Alzheimer's. And that number is projected to about triple by 2050. Now, that's scary, and that has a lot of people thinking and wondering and worrying. And when you consider the typical experience of adults living with dementia, I can see why they're worried, because more often than not, people go, they start experiencing some brain fog, they may have perception of cognitive decline. They go to their family doctor who says, well, let's get you into the neurologist. We'll do a little bit of testing. They do some pencil and paper testing, maybe a little bit of imaging. The neurologist comes back and says, well, you're in the early stages of Alzheimer's disease, or you have dementia, or you have mild cognitive impairment. And after that, things get really frustrating for a lot of people, because in so many cases, the answer after that is, well, there's not much we can do. So here's a prescription for some medication. It probably won't work. You can take it if you want to. If you do, let's look for some side effects. But why don't you come back in 6 months and we'll see if you're any worse. And I had a family once describe that as feeling like they were put in a boat by the doctor and taken out to the ocean and shoved out on a rough sea with no oars, and that they were just sort of floating along at the mercy of what was going to come. In addition to that, it's not just individuals that are dealing with cognitive decline that feel at the mercy of those rough waters. It's the family members of them. Almost always, when I'm working with someone who's living with dementia and I get a chance to talk to their kids, their children say, well, what's my risk? Maybe we've done genetic testing with the parents and we figured out, hey, there's some increased risk. And the kids want to say, well, what about me? Does that mean that I'm just pegged? I'm marked for life? It's going to happen? That's really what we want to talk about today, because you're not. And interestingly, people that have genetic tendencies toward Alzheimer's often are some of the best to respond to intervention and early prevention. So leading the charge in understanding how to deal with Alzheimer's disease is Dr. Dale Bredesen, who's a neurologist at UCLA that's been studying Alzheimer's and what to do about it for the last 30 years. And he's developed some really key insights regarding the disease. Among them, I think his biggest insight is that there's no one factor that causes Alzheimer's disease. It's actually caused by many different things that come together, and it looks different from person to person. Therefore, the way that we intervene, whether it's preventively or in response to symptoms, needs to be very personalized. He wrote about his research in a book called The End of Alzheimer's. Maybe you've read it. Maybe you've read the follow-up book that he published, The End of Alzheimer's Program. I love this quote from one of his books, that Alzheimer's should be a rare disease, just like leprosy or polio. In other words, it shouldn't be happening. When's the last time you met somebody with leprosy or polio, especially in the United States? It's a very rare thing. Yeah, we've heard about them. We know about it. That's how he suggests that Alzheimer's disease should be, genetics or not. So today we hope to give you some real hope and some key insights about what you can do to either respond to Alzheimer's disease and understand better the signaling pathways that lead to it and what you do about it, or if you've got a family history of it, what that might mean and what you can do to prevent going down that pathway. Randy Vaudry is going to talk us through some of these signaling pathways and some of these genetic tendencies and how they really affect us. So sit tight, you're in for a real treat. I'm gonna hand it over to Randy.
Thank you, Eric, I appreciate it. Like you, when I heard Dr. Bredesen say that Alzheimer's should be as rare as leprosy or polio, it blew my mind, because I've been practicing medicine for a little less than 20 years, and I have never seen leprosy, ever. I've never seen it in any client. I don't know anyone that's ever had leprosy. I have seen patients who have post-polio effects, but I've never met anyone with active disease. So to suggest that Alzheimer's should be as rare as leprosy or polio really makes you scratch your head and think, what are we doing wrong in our society? Why is this happening with the prevalence that it is? Because many people predict that Alzheimer's is now the third leading cause of death, and that the rates of Alzheimer's are far less known to worldwide than what is actually happening. So many people are chalking up brain fog and problems with their memory to a bad night's sleep or maybe a little extra wine last night. And the truth is there's a lot more that's underlying. So I wanna create this picture for all of our attendees. And it's to think that there's about 100 billion brain cells, okay, in everyone's brains. And every single day, the choices that we make predict whether or not we support those brain cells or we injure them to the point that they just kind of die off. Now, that's a pretty sobering thought, that to think that every day our decisions predict or start stacking pebbles onto the side of a scale is whether or not that scale tips one way or another. So let me give you just a simple example of this. Many of these are things that you may not even consider are risk factors for Alzheimer's disease. So Eric, do you wanna go to the next slide? Think about what time you go to bed every day. And then what time do you get up? My patient zero, the very first patient that I ever started working with specific to the enhanced protocol, was a fellow and his wife that got into a habit of Netflixing every night. They were binge watching television shows or binge watching movies, and their standard is they would start a television show at 6 or 7 o'clock at night, and they would binge watch up until about 3 o'clock in the morning. And they did this every single night. Well, I spent a lot of time in my first visit talking about how that affected the brain. And I think they were coming to me thinking, Randy, why don't you tell us something important instead of talking to us like you're our mother and we should stop Netflixing all night long? I don't think they realized that that decision dramatically impacts the way they form brain cells. How about, did you exercise today? Exercise increases blood flow and it delivers nutrients and it takes away toxins. Did you have a little bit of caffeine? Caffeine's not a bad thing. Caffeine can kind of wake us up. It can perk some of those synaptic membranes. How about alcohol? I talk to a ton of clients who have a little bit of alcohol every night. In fact, one of my colleagues told me that when I challenged her to be really thoughtful about continuing to drink alcohol, she came to me very quietly a couple weeks later and said, Randy, I had no idea how much that actually impacted how I felt, because I didn't drink that much, but it made a huge difference when I eliminated it altogether. Think about what medicines you might take or that your parents take. If you do a Google search and you search for the top 5 medicines and their potential side effects, It'll blow your mind what you see. Here's what Harvard says are some of the top five challenges with medicines. Blood pressure medicines called ACE inhibitors can cause vasoconstriction. Diabetes medicine like metformin or Actos dramatically changes the way that our mitochondria function, how we produce energy in our cells. If you're on a cholesterol-lowering medicine called a statin, it completely wipes out an antioxidant called CoQ10. And I would be wealthy if all of the people who take a statin gave me a dollar if they didn't take CoQ10. And yet if you read the FDA insert, CoQ10 is recommended as an antidote to the challenges with cholesterol-lowering medicines called statins. Perhaps the most significant side effects come from over-the-counter medicines called painkillers like Tylenol or ibuprofen. I don't think people realize how complex some of these medicines can be at impacting our liver or at impacting our GI system. And in a society where the standard American diet and acid reflux medicines, and then we add ibuprofen on top of that, it creates a whirlwind of challenges that can dramatically affect the brain. How about fast food? Eat fast food. Fast food is usually made with really inexpensive vegetable oils that can tolerate high temperatures before they go rancid. Now, right here in sunny Arizona, you know how important that is? You can't have a fast food restaurant that puts a high quality extra virgin olive oil on their shelf and then it goes rancid in the storage room because it's 110 degrees. So we have to use these seed oils that have been hydrogenated and they've been refined and changed so many times that they really shouldn't ever spoil, but they become part of our cellular membranes and they create a problem. How about stress? Stress can dramatically impact the way that our mind functions. Or are you insulin resistant, or what's your blood sugar level? Did you know that the number one cause of Alzheimer's worldwide is insulin resistance? And I'm not even talking about pre-diabetes, or I'm not talking about diabetes. This is kind of the pre-stages that can make a difference. How about your vitamin D level? We've been told forever to put sunscreen on and don't get more than 10 minutes, 15 minutes of direct sunlight every day on our skin. Well, there's a threshold of vitamin D at which when that drops, it changes our immune system and could impact Alzheimer's disease. Do you take narcotics or ibuprofen? Do you have irritable bowel, chronic diarrhea and constipation? How about sleep apnea? Think of the number of people that have sleep apnea. When we talk about those 100 billion brain cells, each one of these things every day predicts whether or not you support that neuron and that synaptic connection, or whether or not you choke it out and starve it out. Are you on estrogen or testosterone? The Mayo Clinic produced a study several years ago that women who have been through early menopause, either because they had a surgery or because of stress or other gynecological challenges, have a 2 or a 3-fold increased risk for Alzheimer's disease because of the way it influences our genetics. And so lastly, that million-dollar question, man, if I've got mom and dad who've both had Alzheimer's disease, I'm shaking in my boots. I don't want that. So we've got to start thinking about what are all of the things that we could do to prevent Alzheimer's disease. And we're going to give you a handful of them today. So think of those nerve receptors and all those choices that I gave you. I just rattled these off when I put together this presentation, but I want you to think, every daily decision, does it stimulate cellular growth or cell death? And specifically, neuronal growth or neuron cell death. And I'm going to actually give you some of the science. So I'm going to go a little technical here. So if for all the nerdy people out there who want to understand the science, I'm going to cover it, but then I'll quickly swing back into some of the lay discussions. So when you promote cell growth, you get smarter and you get more coordinated and your balance gets better and your memory improves and your recall improves and your ability to find words and language gets better. These are all predictors that cell growth is occurring and it's strengthening. So when people have those senior moments and they say, oh my gosh, what's that word again? I can't remember. Or they're constantly, I had one lady that says, Randy, it's terrible. I wake up in the morning and think I got to go to the store. So I back out of my driveway And I start driving down the street and I realize I left my wallet. So I got to go back to my house and I get my wallet. And then I get to the grocery store and I think, oh my gosh, I forgot my list. I don't even remember what to get at the grocery store. We can chalk that up as a senior moment, or we can take heed that that is a symptom of an underlying problem. And if we address it early on, we can prevent Alzheimer's in the future. But instead, we've just grown to accept that these senior moments are that we get a little bit more forgetful, we get a little bit more memory loss, we start having fall risk and balance problems, we can't remember words. And in reality, we have to start recognizing that represents neuron cell death in our brains. It's a very sobering thought, but the reality is Alzheimer's disease starts about 20 years before anyone ever receives a diagnosis of Alzheimer's. So it makes perfect sense to start recognizing those events early in life so we can do something about it. And I want you to think about brain health like it's a switch. Now, I know this feels very simplistic to many of you, but you can switch on many mechanisms that stimulate cellular growth and cell optimization and healthy brain functioning and synaptic connections. You can switch that on, or you can completely switch it off. And when we switch it off, it leads to a process called apoptosis, or natural cell death, when our cells start falling asleep and pretty soon just stop working. When we flip that switch, the term in medicine that we use towards cellular growth and regeneration is called a CERT1 pathway. That pathway has been studied extensively by David Sinclair, who's written all about longevity and health. And it's been blogged about by Richard Isaacson at Cornell University and Mark Hyman at the Cleveland Clinic. Many of these guys talk about turning on that CERT1 pathway, which is very anti-inflammatory and very growth promoting. Or we can switch on a pathway called the cellular death pathway. It's called the NF-kappa-B. I can explain a little bit more how that works, but I want to talk about the receptors for a minute, because the question always comes up of what about amyloid beta and kind of this amyloid beta hypothesis. So I want to explain how this works. In our brain, on every nerve cell in our brain, we have a receptor called APP, amyloid precursor protein. And amyloid precursor protein is kind of like a thermostat or a barometer. And that sits in the environment in the brain and it measures many variables associated with brain health. And when those variables are healthy and the right variables are there, we snip that little protein into two peptides. One's called APP alpha and alpha CTF. And these are peptides that promote cell growth. But when the environment is not healthy, that little APP protein gets snipped into four different smaller proteins. And one of them I've highlighted in a box called amyloid beta. Now, the reason I bring this up, I know it's very scientific. The reason I bring this up is that for years and years, we argued that amyloid beta was likely the cause of Alzheimer's disease. And that's because people would get Alzheimer's and pass away. And then pathologists would do autopsies and they would take parts of their brain and they would study them under a microscope and they would find just enormous amounts of this protein called amyloid beta. And so they thought, gosh, whatever's causing this amyloid beta must be the cause of Alzheimer's disease. Until Del Bredesen came along, Del Bredesen said, you know what? Amyloid beta is not the cause of Alzheimer's disease. It's actually just the manifestation of, and it is produced in response to many cellular signals that are occurring in the brain. And those signals lead to cell death. So I'm going to give you an example on my next slide of how amyloid beta is predictive and associated with Alzheimer's disease. So sometimes I've tried to explain it this way, that amyloid might be similar or analogous to a white blood cell. And in the brain, we have white blood cells that are called microglia. But let's change it from Alzheimer's, and let me give you an example of strep throat. If you had strep throat and we checked your blood count, we would see that your blood count was very, very elevated because it's responding to the bacteria in our throat called streptococcus. And so just think for a second, what if our treatment of strep throat was to get rid of all of our white blood cells? Because we know that in the event that you have strep throat, your white cells just grow exponentially. Everyone listening to this would say, that's ludicrous, Randy. Why would you get rid of your red blood or white blood cells? They're not causing the strep throat. They're just responding to it. And that's the same with amyloid. Amyloid beta is produced in response to an environment where brain cells are being lost. And the more amyloid beta we get, it's because the immune system, like the microglia or that amyloid precursor protein that I just talked about, is not appreciating the environment that's there. And so it produces amyloid beta in response to that environment, okay? So the second bullet is that amyloid beta basically is the brain response to a bad signal or multiple bad signals. If you got all kinds of bad signals going on, you're gonna start producing a lot more amyloid beta, and it's going to appear like you have Alzheimer's disease. Now, currently, the only clear definitive diagnosis for Alzheimer's disease is an autopsy, but we can look at trends and characteristics and predict it with a pretty high level of accuracy. So amyloid beta's production is stimulated by that very inflammatory pathway called the NF-kappa B that I explained. And that NF-kappa B often occurs because of an infection that occurs. And you might think, well, is it an infection in the brain like meningitis? It could be, but it could also be an infection in one of your molars, because that infection gets transmitted through the root and gets pushed right up under that blood-brain barrier into your brain. It can be affected by a toxin. Like, let's say that every day you have really hot coffee from the gas station in a styrofoam cup. And then we get plastics that leach out into that coffee that result in an antibody against the plastics. And in response, we produce amyloid beta. Maybe it's a massive stressor. And I can talk about that here in a minute. So generally speaking, amyloid beta has a greater predictive ratio to our lifestyle than it actually does to our genetics. Now, that's very encouraging for those of us that have strong family histories of Alzheimer's disease, because we don't want to feel like we're screwed, that, hey, tough luck, mom and dad got it, Randy, so I'm just destined to get it. That's not the case. I can have the genetics for lung cancer, but if I never smoke, the likelihood of getting lung cancer is actually very, very low. And so if I have the genetics for Alzheimer's disease, the actuality that I'll get it can be quite low if I adopt a lifestyle that makes a significant difference on those signaling pathways that I've talked about. So we have tremendous influence over whether or not we produce amyloid beta by the truckload, or we produce very small amounts, or that we can actually clear it. So let me give you a really cool thought. When we get strep throat and we produce a ton of white blood cells, they don't hang around forever. We're not just destined to have these massive loads of white blood cells over and over. The body recycles those and gets rid of them. So thank goodness for that, because if you've had a virus or you've been sick and you just produce white blood cells and your body never gets rid of them, God, you're going to clot. You're just going to have tons of problems with white blood cells. We can get rid of them, and we can get rid of amyloid beta in much the same way. So the interesting component is that every drug trial, I should say not everyone, trials in the last several years have had the focus on how do we get rid of amyloid beta. And they've all proven to be failures. We have about a 99% failure rate after spending hundreds of billion dollars in drug trials. And it's because we're trying to get rid of amyloid beta instead of trying to get rid of the signaling that is driving the production of amyloid beta. Isn't that a cool thought? I think it's so encouraging for people that have strong family histories of Alzheimer's who have been tested positive for having the APOE gene. So I love this slide. I did not produce this slide, so I give credit and put the reference at the bottom of the slide. But I want you to pay attention that in our society, we focus so much on the disease and not necessarily the underlying causes. So superficially, we're talking about cancers and allergies and diabetes and high blood pressure, diabetes and thyroid and depression. But we only have 5 or 10 minutes every time we go to our doctor because they're so busy. There's just no time to really dig deep and start talking about how does genetics predict the expression and therefore the onset of disease? How does your stress or your diet or your lack of sleep or nutrient deficiencies, how are those underlying roots predicting how that tree of disease grows? So you've got to think of the same way when it comes to Alzheimer's disease. That amyloid beta is just the outward manifestation. And if you drill back to the roots, you can find the root cause. And when you make changes in that, you can dramatically impact people's lives for the better. So I'll give you another couple of examples of how that can happen. Let's say that the red curve is natural aging. And as aging goes on over time, so you'll see underneath the star, it's about 60, 65, that red line starts taking a dive and that slope starts heading south. And when we're talking about our cognitive function, our language skills, we can't find words, our thinking and recall and short-term memory and motor skills, attention and focus, everything starts going south and we chalk it up, oh my gosh, I'm having a senior moment. But if we intervene early on and we start doing some testing, we can change the slope of that line. So see that purple line? This is often what I talk to my patients about. Look, I don't care when you start. You start early, we can smooth out that curve so that you don't have ongoing deterioration. I'll talk about the blue line here in a minute. So let's go on to the next slide. Let me show you another example. Amyloid beta that's produced through that certain signaling pathway has a very exaggerated response to a handful of things, okay? So number one, amyloid beta is driven in response to some sort of inflammation. So think to yourself, do you have arthritis or some form of autoimmune disease? Or do you constantly get sick? Have you had repeat cold sores on your lip like shingles? Or this is herpes one, or shingles is another manifestation of herpes. It's just later on. How about Epstein-Barr, dental decay, viruses, bacteria? Have you been on a truckload of antibiotics over the course of your life? Or have you had C. diff? Or do you get irritable bowel or constipation? These are all manifestations of inflammation. And if you have those characteristics, there's a high likelihood that you're producing amyloid beta and it's happening very silently. You've got to address that. How about atrophy of the brain cells? Those are directly related to growth supporting nutrients like vitamin B1. Do you know what the number one cause of a loss of vitamin B1 is worldwide? It's that glass of wine every night. It's a little bit of beer. That over time, that diminishes vitamin B1. How about vitamin B2, riboflavin? B3 is niacin, B6, pyridoxine 5-phosphate, B9 is folic acid. Almost everybody knows how important it is to take a prenatal vitamin for a mother who's expecting a child. And one of the reasons we do that is they're loaded with folic acid, vitamin B9. Without that, that developing fetus is at very high risk for neural tube defects or brain damage. How about magnesium, copper, zinc levels, estrogen, progesterone, testosterone? Hold on, Randy, you gotta wait just a minute. I've been told over and over, if I take hormone replacement, it's gonna cause cancer or blood clots. No, those are relative. And let me tell you this, if you are at high risk for Alzheimer's disease, that's probably more of an absolute risk based on genetics, then it would make perfect sense to be willing to accept a little bit of relative risk for such a low incidence of breast cancer associated with hormone replacement. Everyone's different. I'm not diagnosing or treating, but I just want to give you an example. We should be really thoughtful about these things if you have a strong family history of Alzheimer's disease. We should consider brain-derived neurotrophic factor, BDNF or NGF, or omega-3s, cholines, proteins, antioxidants, oxygenation, right? If you have obstructive sleep apnea, you should stay on that CPAP device and you should get tested periodically to make sure that we've optimized your treatment. The last one, and I saw Pam talk about this. Hi, Pam, it's great to have you. Thanks for joining us again. The brain responds very unfavorably to elevated blood sugar and elevated insulin. In fact, here's a fun fact. If you were to drain all the blood out of the human body and then calculate how much sugar it is, how much sugar is in our bloodstream, do you have any idea how much sugar there's actually there? There's probably less than 1 teaspoon. 1 teaspoon of sugar in your entire bloodstream. Now think of that in the context of when we have a large Coke or a large soda and a large piece of cake and a bowl of ice cream and all those things. Think of how many teaspoons of sugar are in those servings. The body's got to figure out what to do with it. And it becomes very troublesome for the body to try to figure out how to clear that sugar from our bloodstream. And the brain just struggles with that. It doesn't like it. So it's not just sugar, but it's the actual insulin resistance and the influence of insulin specifically in our brain. Dr. Bredesen has said, every single person with APOE4 genetics has some level of cerebral insulin resistance. Now, whether or not you've been diagnosed with that or not, it's up here. And so you've got to be thoughtful about how the diet plays into stroking brain health, okay? And there are many medicines that actually make insulin resistance worse. So you gotta be thoughtful. Dr. Bredesen was such a brilliant scientist and he classified types of Alzheimer's disease. So here's your analogy. If I asked all of our participants today, give me a cause of a headache. Some people would say, well, I get a headache every time I get a sinus infection. And someone else would say, well, I get a headache if I don't get enough sleep. And another might say, well, I got a headache the other day when I stood up and smacked my head on the cabinet and I got this sore that caused a headache. Each of those headaches have a similar symptom, right? Our head hurts, but they're all caused by something different. And that's how we have to start thinking of dementia. There's dementias that are caused by inflammatory disorders. So certain APOE genetics or MTHFR genetics. And we should always be looking at things like homocysteine and CRP. Everyone on this call should know what their albumin to globulin ratio is because it predicts bowel health and indirectly predicts cerebral health. We can know what our TGF-1, interleukin-6, tumor necrosis factor alpha, there's lots of inflammatory markers that give us guidance as to whether or not we're predicting an environment that produces amyloid and therefore Alzheimer's disease. Insulin resistance can be part of that. In the blue slide, we talk about atrophic forms of dementia. Atrophic means that this form of dementia causes atrophy. That's where the atrophic comes from. Atrophy of our neurons. And that can occur by things like very high FSH because follicle stimulating hormone predicts that insulin or that estrogen is very low. We can look at progesterone and DHEA, pregnenolone, thyroid. I spoke with a neurologist right here in Phoenix yesterday and I asked her, tell me a little bit about how you approach thyroid. And she says, oh my gosh, Randy, I think it's so undertreated. And I, especially if someone has cognitive decline, I will send them to an endocrinologist. And sometimes I get the notice back and the endocrinologist says, I don't see anything wrong with the thyroid. I think we just leave it. And the neurologist is thinking, are you kidding me? This is dramatically impacting how the brain works. And so that neurologist tends to be a little bit more ambitious at optimizing thyroid. That was like music to my ears. I was so grateful to hear that. Dr. Bredesen talks about how Alzheimer's disease is really an insufficiency syndrome. I have a client from Texas who recently went through all kinds of vitamin and nutritional therapy. And then they say, okay, well, now what? And I say, you can't rest on your laurels. You've got to continue to optimize those vitamins over time. Getting an IV once a month probably isn't enough to do that. If you've had a hysterectomy, we should have a serious conversation about hormone replacement. In the middle, glycotoxic dementia, I'm not going to spend any time because everyone pretty well understands if you eat the standard American diet, which we kind of joke is pretty sad, You're going to have lots of challenges with cognitive disorders. And it's loaded with highly processed foods, soda pop, sweet drinks, Gatorade. Look at the money that's made advertising Gatorade after exercise. 99% of the world does not need Gatorade after exercise. A little bit of water would work just fine to rehydrate us, right? We get plenty of salts and electrolytes from our foods. Eric, let's go on to the next slide. There's types of toxic dementias that create this vile atmosphere for the brain. So we've all heard how valuable fish is for the diet. Many vegetarians or vegans will have fish as their only meat source. And that's really all that they're getting in terms of protein outside of non-animal proteins. And I have a client where this client ate fish 3 times a week. And when we checked his mercury levels, they were through the roof. He was in the 99th percentile for mercury. So his entire life, he felt like, I'm doing it right. I'm eating the foods that are very healthy. And in return, he ended up having very high levels of mercury. So you might be thinking, good grief, I'm damned if I do and damned if I don't. And the answer is, well, you just have to be thoughtful. You've got to do some testing. You've got to look at these variables. People with toxic dementia typically have problems with executive dysfunction and word finding more early on than they have problems with memory. And we have to go through some chelative processes to get rid of that. One of the individuals on our call sent me a little notice that said, hey, I got family members with vascular dementia. That's a blood flow problem. When that happens, there's often strokes or TIAs or mini strokes. We need to be very thoughtful about looking at obstructive sleep apnea. And we consider supplements like vinpocetine and pycnogenol and natokinase, things that help focus on restoring blood flow. In our services, we use exercise with oxygen. It's an EWAT device developed by LiveO2. So there's a lot of things you can do. Microcirculation benefits through pulsed electromagnetic frequencies can make a big difference on circulation through capillary beds that may not be so driven by heart rate, right? It can make a big difference. And then finally, I just want to wrap this up talking about a form of dementia that we call traumatic or dazed dementia, where someone's had head injury after head injury after head injury. And the second bullet on that bottom slide is that we treat a traumatic dementia much like an inflammatory dementia and atrophic dementia. So we start optimizing all the nutrients and the hormones, and we really work to suppress inflammation and restore blood flow. So this just gives you an example. When these things go awry, an individual in response to these elements starts producing amyloid beta. And so I want you to think to yourself, am I as crisp as I was when I was 20 or 30 years old? One of our clients was the chief financial officer for a very large university. And she managed spreadsheets her entire life. And she noticed that as she aged, it started getting more difficult to come up with the calculations and to tally these spreadsheets. This is a task that she had mastered over her lifetime. And she noted that slope was starting to go down. And when she joined us and started the enhanced protocol, that slope leveled out. In fact, some of the things that she had lost came back. And this is where I want to show you the next slide, right? Is that blue line. It's not just that you can level out the decline. The purple line basically suggests, look, the decline can stop and it can just kind of hang out. But we have experienced and we firmly believe that if we can identify those drivers and those signals of amyloid beta, that curve starts going up. Because the very lady that I talked about came back after several months and she could now remember her telephone number and the street that she lived on. And I wish I could play the video, but it's so amazing. She joked, she says, that seems so stupid, but these are memories that she had lost and she started gaining them back. And the more that she participates and the more that she engages that signaling pathway in her brain, the better she continues to get. And it just takes a little bit of help because sometimes individuals have kind of an inkling, but there's so many compounding factors that they need a coach, they need guidance, they need a little bit of assistance to help them stay on that straight and narrow path. If any of you were like me, I know every day what I should eat. And I don't always eat perfect every day. I know that I should get up and exercise. And when my five-year-old is just raising Cain all night long and I get calls because I'm on call through my work or whatever, I think, and I just don't get a good night's sleep, I don't wake up and feel like exercising. Well, guess what? That means I'm human. And there's no criticism of that. But if that becomes my routine day after day after day, then you better believe I'm going to change that signaling pathway the wrong direction. And amyloid beta is going to start building up in my brain and put me at dramatic risk for Alzheimer's disease. Okay. So our next slide, Eric. Okay. Thanks so much. So let's talk briefly about what you can do day after day. And we've kind of joked and called these the Daily Five. We've got an acronym, but I'll just make it really clear. Diet is probably amongst the most significant and most beneficial thing that you can do to prevent Alzheimer's disease. And if you have any element of risk, you should consider different energy sources of producing amyloid beta. And so, Eric, I'm actually going to turn the time over to you and let you finish this part of the discussion.
Sure. No problem. Thank you, Randy. And I'm going to go pretty quick because I want to make sure that we have time for some of your questions and comments as we go through this. But in talking about the Daily Five, we're really exploring things that allow us to cut that amyloid production, regardless of what genetics might be. It's been said many times that genetics loads the gun, but our choices pull the trigger. Randy mentioned earlier that when it comes to amyloid production and when it comes to Alzheimer's disease, people who are living with Alzheimer's have an energy deficit kind of situation. So when it comes to diet, number one, we should remember to keep our sugars low, because when they become high, that drives insulin resistance and that makes it harder for us to use fuel. Number two, we should remember if we have genetic tendencies toward Alzheimer's disease and we're sort of, for lack of a better way of putting it, pegged from the start with an insulin resistance problem, we can be thoughtful about managing that by eating more healthy fats and keeping our sugars even lower than we might otherwise. When it comes to exercise, Dr. Bredesen has actually said in one of his books that if you have the most common genetic tendency that elevates Alzheimer's risk, and you exercise daily, you reduce your risk to where it's basically the same as the general population. That's how important exercise is. And I'm not going to get into all the particulars of exactly what exercise does, because we all just intuitively know that it's good for us. Not everybody realizes just how good it is for the brain. Every study that's ever been done on exercise shows that it's phenomenal for the brain. With sleep, sleep is also crucial because that's when the body takes out the trash. Metabolically, there's a whole lot of cleaning up that happens while we're sleeping. And if we get less than 7 or 8 hours, or if our sleep is impaired because we have sleep apnea and it's not being treated, then it's a disaster. Imagine walking around all day with someone with their hands around your neck, squeezing. We all know what happens if someone squeezes around the neck too tight for too long. Your brain has no oxygen and you die. If you have sleep apnea and you've got that low level constriction all night long, it's kind of like someone's choking you like that. And it's just cutting off your oxygen. So be really thoughtful about sleep. Next, we need to focus on stress management. We live in a really stressful world, and there are many techniques that can help us reduce stress. So I invite you to look up some of those techniques, practice breathing exercises, practice yoga or Tai Chi, or other things that help you really keep your stress level low. Elevated stress causes deterioration in the memory center of the brain. So if you want to preserve that and stay sharp, keep your stress down. And finally, brain training is important. And people ask me all the time, well, should I do crossword puzzles or Sudoku or what do I do? I would suggest that having novel cognitive experience is what makes the difference. New things. Crossword puzzles are great, but you're using the same well-worn pathways day after day after day. You'd actually get further in terms of brain training by brushing your teeth with your non-dominant hand. or trying to write with your non-dominant hand, or learning a new instrument, or even traveling to a new place and trying to navigate without a map. Having a new experience forces your brain to make new connections. And that, or programs that sort of shift and change as you go through them, things like Brain HQ or Lumosity, also may have some benefit in combination with these other types of approaches. Now, we have given you in advance, and if you didn't get it, just email Lori and she'll get you a copy of it, a summation that comes from Dr. Bredesen's first book of different ways that we give ourselves Alzheimer's disease. And it's kind of a tongue-in-cheek look at things, and it goes through all sorts of different factors. We wanted to share that with you so that you would have the idea that these are controllable things. These are lifestyle choices. These are decisions that we can make day in, day out. And yeah, we might fall off the wagon one day, like Randy was talking about. But when they become a habit, when they become our pattern, then just like compound interest can work in our favor or against us, our good choices compounded over time can make massive gains in our well-being. And our bad choices compounded over time can really be to our detriment. So I invite you to look over that and think about what change you could make as a result of all of this. Now, a lot of people say, well, there's nothing you can do for Alzheimer's disease. I mean, what are you going to do? I guess you can exercise a little bit more. You can try to eat better, but if you got the genetics for it, you're probably going to get it. I don't think that that's true at all. I think whether you have Alzheimer's disease or you have a family history of it, there is a ton of stuff that you can do. When you understand the signaling pathways in the brain that Randy was talking about and all the different ways that things can tip, you have powerful insights that allow you to make different and better decisions that change the way that your trajectory of aging goes. Well, we are excited that the Summit at Sunland Springs offers the enhanced protocol. We're excited that they have a brain health clinic there, and that they are able to allow people to have access to the kind of lab work that Randy's talking about, to coaching to get through these sorts of things, to have some guidance, because if you hadn't noticed, this gets a little bit complex. So we'd like to introduce not only an opportunity to have some discussion and some Q&A, but also the chance for you to meet Robeson, who's the memory coach at the Summit, so that you can get a sense of who's there in the Arizona area to just guide you through some of these situations. Robeson, if you'd like to say hi for just a minute, we'll give people a chance to put any questions in the comments here.
Howdy, folks. My name is Robeson Flynn. I'm the memory coach here at the memory clinic at the Summit. We've been running the enhanced protocol here for about 3 years. And we've, you know, seen some really amazing things with, you know, folks who do have that APOE gene. We, a lot of times when we meet with family members, we come to the point where their loved one has one APOE4 from each parent. They'd be a 4-4. They have the gene from each parent. So it's an uncomfortable conversation. Like, well, that's, you guess what? You have the gene as well. And, you know, I heard from families, it's, you know, I don't have any, you know, cognitive issues. And so, well, you know, maybe we can prevent that and, you know, focus on your diet a little bit and, you know, point you in the right direction. And, you know, I've gotten word from family members like, gosh, you know, I didn't realize what cognition I'd lost. And, you know, I feel my brain is so much clearer now. So there is definitely things you can do to mitigate the risk of that particular gene.
Thanks, Robeson. We've got lots of questions here. Just a quick comment. People ask me all the time, well, should I even pursue something like the enhanced protocol if my loved one has the genetics for Alzheimer's? I mean, is it going to go as well? And actually, in our experience, the people that have genetic tendencies toward Alzheimer's are some of the very best responders to the whole program. So keep that in mind. Now, there's a lot of stuff going on in the comments right now. A lot of things coming out as far as the value of exercise and talk about routine. I think it might be valuable to point out that when it comes to routine, if someone has more advanced dementia, routine becomes sort of a crutch. It becomes really helpful. And if life is not enough routine to them, it's a serious problem. But when we don't have dementia and we're trying to give our brains novel experience, changing things up is extremely helpful. So this, even a point as simple as routine and what routine is good or should we change it up, reminds us that this all has to be very personalized. There's no one size fits all approach. We need to take the individual experience and customize it. Let's look at some of these other questions here. Randy, you've been going through the chat. What are some other things that you've seen that might be good to comment on?
Somebody asked the question about, is Flonase bad for me? Because Flonase is a nasal steroid that we inhale oftentimes because we have a lot of allergies. And Flonase in and of itself, I'm not sure is bad for you, but whatever is causing you to have those chronic allergies might be bad for you. And so remember, allergies are when the immune system gets all fired up. And a fun fact is that the majority of our immune system actually is derived from our GI system. So when someone has terrible allergies, we start with diet as our primary intervention to get rid of those allergies. That doesn't always work, but that's certainly a good place to start. And there's things like low histamine diets and there's common food allergens. So those are things that we would address. And I could tell you that I at least have a 50% success rate with clients who have terrible chronic sinus allergies. This part of their brain is always inflamed. When they change their diet, that gets better, okay? Someone asks, are sucrose and fructose inflammatory as well as glucose? And the answer is often dependent on the individual. So fructose is metabolized very differently from glucose, right? Fructose is metabolized primarily by the liver. And so if an individual has fatty liver disease or insulin resistance or non-alcoholic fatty liver, they drink a lot of alcohol, the way the liver processes fructose could change. So that could create an underlying problem. Glucose in and of itself can be very inflammatory because as our blood sugar goes up, our inflammatory markers usually follow right up along with that, right? So very good question. Someone else has talked about the power of exercise and how beneficial the power of exercise is. And I've been responding to people on our chats about what form of exercise do you like the most? And people often say, Randy, what's the very best form of exercise? And I joke because I say, look, the best form of exercise is whatever you'll always do, whatever you'll consistently engage in. I happen to really appreciate a form of exercise where you combine a little aerobic and a little resistance training. And this morning, my wife and I got up early out in beautiful Arizona where the air was, it was just crisp, but it was great because I typically live in Idaho and it's freezing cold there. And we walked around the neighborhood and we did our own little Olympics where we did squats and lunges and we stepped up on a park bench several times and got down and did push-ups and we just kind of created our own little CrossFit today. It was kind of fun. So someone asked the question, as a type 1 diabetic, am I more likely to get Alzheimer's disease? And the answer is there certainly is risk trending that direction because blood sugar and elevated insulin levels can induce a little bit of an inflammatory response. So it kind of depends on how that blood sugar is managed. And here's a very general response. Remember, I'm not treating over the internet, I'm just giving guidelines and some thoughts. Oftentimes we treat diabetes by using a medicine like insulin, and then we make sure we get a certain amount of carbohydrates so we don't bottom that out. And many of my type 1 diabetics have found that they can dramatically lower the amount of insulin that they're required to use to manage that disease by being very thoughtful about their dietary intake. So those are some ways that we help minimize the risk of that inflammatory response in Alzheimer's. I'm not sure I answered all the questions, but Lori, we might be out of time. Where should we go from here?
We do have one question that came through that I think we should address. And that is somebody that doesn't know their family history. Maybe they don't have their parents around or have a family to look at. What is the testing that can be done to be able to help identify if somebody has these genetic issues?
Love it. The first thing that I would encourage that that individual to do is an online cognitive screening called CNS Vital Signs. CNS Vital Signs asks a series of questions. It takes about an hour to do that test. And when you do that test, it will compare your score to the average person your age that has no cognitive disorders, right? So you know how you compare with someone who is cognitively healthy. And if you start showing some risk factors there, you should dig deeper. The second part of my question is that the number one gene that I talked about today is called the APOE gene. The APOE gene is a predictor of cognitive risk relative to Alzheimer's disease. It's not the only gene, but it's very simple to do. It's not very expensive, and it's something that I encourage everyone to know their APOE status.
Will you go ahead and put in the chat box before we go away that CNS website or the CNS testing that you're mentioning?
Yes. So you can go online and read about CNS Vital Signs, but I don't think you can just take the test directly from the company. They always link the test results and send it to a practitioner. So you can do it through a Mind for All Seasons. You can do it through the Summit. You just let us know. The testing costs $50 to do. It's very simple. And we can send you a link. You do the testing, the results come, and then we talk through it. So
very cool. For those of you that are located in Arizona, we have an incredible opportunity to do another presentation with Randy. He is going to be speaking down in a local community in the East Mesa area. If you would like to be able to hear another presentation tomorrow at 6 p.m. Arizona time, please send me an email back. And we would love to be able to invite you and have you come and get to see Randy in person. Randy Robeson and myself will be there for a presentation on depression in seniors and alternative ways to be able to manage that versus just the magic pill. I thought this presentation was really interesting. You know, I love some of the takeaways on how your body needs to be able to take out the trash and all the different body functions that have to happen in order to regenerate and get ready for the next day, as well as how things are compounded, the good and the bad. So with that, I think it was such a helpful presentation. For those that attended, we will go ahead and email back out the handout that was mentioned on the lifestyle changes that can be made, or just the progression. This lifestyle choice creates this result, as well as the recording of this presentation to either watch again or to share. If you have questions, Randy has popped his email address into the chat box. You're certainly welcome to reach out to Robeson or myself. Eric, would you put up the screen for Robeson's contact information?
You bet.
Thank you. And feel free to email Robeson at thesummitaz.com or I'm Lori at thesummitaz.com. We'd love to show you the memory clinic at the summit, be able to show you some of the therapies that we work through, as well as help you with any of the testing, or if you would like to do a free memory screening, we can do that as well. Wanted to say thank you, everybody, for participating. I certainly do appreciate it. Thank you, guys.
Thanks, everybody.
Thanks, guys.